Thank you very much, Nancy, and thank you for inviting me to speak here. Indeed, I did first come to know your institution here when it was called the Waste Management Research Center, and I was very pleased to do some work with Tim and his associates here, looking at how ultrafiltration could help railroads reduce their pollution from their mechanical shops. But okay, we're going to get the slideshow now. There we go. Okay. Anyway, as Nancy said, I came here about 11 years ago now, and the role was to rebuild our railroad engineering program, which is the longest and oldest in North America, and I think we've been succeeding. We now have a second full-time faculty member and a third adjunct, and postdocs and graduate students, all the usual things, and as the world seems to be starting to rediscover rail, that's making our life very busy, but not in a bad way. And actually, what I'm going to be talking about today combines two of the things that were mentioned in the introduction, namely our work on energy efficiency and our work on new technologies. So let me get started. And the first one always takes time to advance, but first, let me acknowledge the people who really did most of the work that I'm going to be talking about. And it's a, as will be evident, this is a team project between the Civil Engineering Department and people in the Beckman Institute from Electrical and Computer Engineering. But a lot of the work you're going to be hearing about was done by my former graduate student, Yung Cheng Lai, who's now a faculty member at National Taiwan University, my current colleague, Riley Edwards, and a graduate student of ours, Tristan Rickett. Over in the Beckman Institute, we have Narendra Ahuja, John Hart, and Avinash Kumar. The research that I'm going to be talking about today was sponsored by the BNSF Railway, and who were actually some of the same people that were supportive of the work we were doing on ultrafiltration. So there's kind of a legacy there of interest in environmental performance. Also, we've been very fortunate to have an endowed fellowship from the CN, and so that was used to also support Yung Cheng Lai for some of his research. Outline of my presentation today is I'm going to kind of review the fundamentals of railroad transportation energy efficiency. I'll talk about measuring railroad train resistance. And then I'm going to focus more on intermodal train aerodynamics and train resistance, and then optimizing intermodal train loading to minimize resistance. And then finally, if we have time, I'll talk briefly about the machine vision work to automatically monitor train loading. All right. Well, first, I want to start by asking you all, what's 457? Y'all like to play Jeopardy, right? Anybody know the answer? Haven't been watching enough sort of Sunday morning TV, I guess. The number of miles railroads can move one ton of freight on 1 gallon of fuel. It's really a remarkable statistic if you think about it. But it's true. Actually, I've got a button, lapel pin that the AAR gave me for last year. It was 436, so it's increased 21 miles in just a year as a result of a lot of things they're doing to improve efficiency. Well, so how does that compare to the principal overland competitor for freight traffic in North America, the trucking industry? Anybody want to guess or know? Well, the answer is it's about 3.5 times more efficient than truck. Trucks can move a ton of freight, about 130 miles with 1 gallon of fuel. And so this is, I think for reasons everybody in this room can appreciate, this is a significant difference and has implications not only for now but for the future. But before we talk about the future, let's look at the past. I found this graphic in something that the automobile industry produced in the 1920s. Enough oil for 144 years. There's a big giant, you know, barrel of oil. And then over here we have the 1920 consumption in barrels, and there's the Woolworth building. I guess that was the tallest building at the time. And so, you know, no worries. We got lots of oil, right? Well, I actually think they had it about right. Because what is it, about 70-odd years later now, and how many more years of oil we have left, we don't really know, but it's not obviously an infinite resource. So the point is that during the 20th century, we were sort of, we lived in a profligate era. I mean, we had lots of energy, land, natural resources, labor. We had the dominant economy in the world. But now, as we enter the 21st century, we have diminishing resources. in terms of all of these parameters I'm talking about there. We have increased transportation congestion. And we really need to use our transportation infrastructure and all of our resources more efficiently than we were in the 20th century. But I suspect that most people in our society are unwilling to give up all of this convenience. And so what we really need to do is figure out how to be more efficient. I imagine you guys are familiar with these statistics, but this is just showing the breakdown of petroleum consumption. And you can see that, first of all, transportation dominates the consumption of petroleum. That's that would be good. That's the laser. Okay. So transportation dominates the consumption of petroleum. Within transportation, we have cars, light trucks, heavy trucks. And notice this little thin thing there. That's the rail. So that's consistent with this high degree of efficiency, particularly when you think about that railroads are moving 42% of the intercity ton miles compared to trucks that only move about 30%. So we're moving, you know, 30% more freight by rail than we are by truck, and yet look at the consumption of fuel. So again, it's consistent with this earlier statistic I showed you. All right, so if we want to improve energy efficiency, as good as that is, we still want to further improve railroad energy efficiency. And there's two principal elements to this. And I should say that the next probably 20 slides are basically part of some lectures I give to our some of our classes are adapted a little bit for this audience. But there's two basic elements we want to consider. How much resistance is there? How much work is required to move something? And how efficient we are, how efficiently we convert energy to useful work, and principally in the form of our locomotives that are hauling these trains. This talk is going to talk about the resistance. I'm not going to address the energy efficiency. There's lots of work going on improving energy efficiency of locomotives. Both of the big manufacturers in the U.S. are working on this, and other manufacturers as well. The railroads are very interested. In fact, I just learned recently that the project to develop fuel cell locomotives, it's a joint project between BNSF and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, is actually being managed by people over at Searle. So we'll probably have a seminar by her before too long. And this is an interesting graphic that was produced by a former railway engineering faculty member at the University of Illinois, William Hay. We have speed on this axis, and we have resistance in this axis. And we're looking at the different transportation modes. And we don't have to spend a lot of time on this, but the point is here's pipelines, here's trucks, there's boats, there's airplanes. They're obviously not very efficient. And here's rail. And if what you'll notice here is that rail uniquely combines high speed and, although it's not evident from this graph, capacity, transportation capacity, with low resistance. So if you look at this sort of phase space of transportation and efficiency and resistance, it kind of further suggests why we might be interested in rail transportation as an efficient way of moving things over land. All right, but you're all engineers and scientists, I presume, and you want to understand, well, why is this true? I mean, I show you this graph and say it's true, but what are the underlying reasons for why this is true? Let's first think about what transportation produces. Its output in economic terms is either freight ton miles or passenger miles. And so railroads are efficient in particular because of three important parameters: low rolling friction, large vehicles, and trains. And I'll talk about each of these. First of all, low rolling friction. This is kind of from the realm of theoretical and applied mechanics. Some of you may have had classes in this back in an earlier day. And the things that contribute to rolling friction are, first of all, rolling friction is the resistive force of rolling, and this mu sub r is the coefficient of rolling friction between two surfaces. Well, the mu sub r of a narrow wheel is less than a thick wheel. The mu sub r of a large diameter wheel is less than for a small diameter wheel, and it's also related to weight, because F sub r is inversely proportional to rolling surface hardness. And so where we have a very hard surface, as we do here, compared to this surface, which is a softer surface, we have lower rolling friction. So all of these combine to have an effect on railroads related to trucks. Let's look at some numbers here. The steel wheel on steel rail has lower rolling friction than a rubber tire on pavement. The steel wheel on rail is a Musa bar of about 0.001 compared to a truck tire on pavement, which is about 0.006 to 0.01. In other words, the tire is about 6 to 10 times greater rolling resistance than or Musa bar than the steel wheel. Well, why is this? Well, it's because the rubber tire on pavement, there are small effects of static friction and adhesion on the rubber, but the major factor is the deformation of the tire while rolling under load. You get a lot of friction as a result of that. There's also some pavement deflection. Now, the steel wheel and rail, and this may not be evident to necessarily to people who don't spend a lot of time thinking about railroads, there's also elastic deformation of the steel wheel and the steel rail, but it's much, much smaller. In fact, the entire contact patch of a loaded rail car on a steel rail is about the size of a dime. All right. The other factor is that we can have these large vehicles, large heavy vehicles, and that's because the infrastructure is particularly strong and it's more efficiently optimized to support these heavy loads. Okay, so we have our steel wheel here on our rail, and of course we understand that steel is a very strong material. But what we can do is we can optimize the strength of this entire structure, not only at the wheel-rail interface, but all the way down into the subgrade to support these very, very heavy loads. You could in principle do that with pavement, but think about how much it would cost to have pavement that was so thick and so strong to support these heavy loads. It just wouldn't be economical. And so as a consequence, we have a typical normal North American axle load these days is about 39 tons compared to about 8.5 tons for trucks. So this large size of vehicles permits economies of scale. So again, we have a truck trailer and a typical rail car here and a truck engine here and a locomotive here. The larger vehicles can transport more weight with less resistance per unit. So that's one form of economy of scale. And also the larger engines that are, the diesel engines that are inside these compared to these, can also be more efficient. They can convert energy to work more efficiently. Finally, we have trains. Trains permit two more economies of scale, one of which is not really environmental. It's labor efficiency, but that contributes to economics and the attractiveness of rail transportation to the economy. But the other is very definitely energy and fuel consumption related, and that is this close spacing of rail cars in a train really reduces the aerodynamic resistance that they experience per unit of transport. And this effect is particularly important at speeds above 40 miles an hour, which will become significant later in my talk. So if you think about it, what's happening, these three rail cars are transporting roughly the equivalent of these nine trucks. And so what's happening is, the way I sometimes explain it to my students, the train just has to punch one hole in the atmosphere, whereas these trucks have to punch nine holes in the atmosphere. It's not quite that simple, but that's one of the really important reasons, and again, particularly important at higher speeds. Now, truck trains are possible, and if you go to Australia, you can see them. But would we really want them? And this is probably about the limit of, I think, these five-unit trucks that they have there. Now, there's another aspect, and this is really an aside to this talk, but again, as people who are interested in sustainability, I thought it was worth taking a slide to mention this, which is that rail transport also requires much less land per unit of transport. There's two comparisons made here, and one is a little bit more rigorous than the other, but this is a comparison of passenger transport where you have people in automobiles, people in buses, or a metro or mass transit type system, a rail mass transit system. And here we have just a photograph showing a single track rail line here, which is about the width of one lane of a highway. And then we have, let's say, about a four-lane highway here. It looks like there's some kind of an extra lane there, but let's just say it's a four-lane highway. And if you just count up how many containers or trailers, we have 26 over here and 13 over here. And this traffic is not really quite sure what the congestion level is here, but it's probably right about at the maximum where it wouldn't start to experience some delay or congestion. And there's a reason for, an additional reason for why all this is. So right away we have differences in the efficiency just operating trains versus trucks. But there's another thing which, again, is kind of an aside to this talk, but look at this intersection where we have highly directional traffic. You know, maybe everybody's going home from work, and so it's rush hour. And all of these lanes are congested, and they're probably moving at 20 or 30 miles an hour. And yet look at all the other lanes. They're empty. The reverse movement is has hardly any traffic on it at all. But because you can't easily reverse traffic on highways, whereas you can very easily do that on railroads with the proper appropriate centralized control system, you can use a lot less land for the same amount of transportation capacity. All right, but let's get back to energy and resistance. Since the days of, train resistance really started to become a science. Measurement of train resistance became a science in the first couple decades of this of the 20th century. And in fact, some of the fundamental work was done right here on this campus. Two faculty members in what was then the Department of Railway Engineering actually did a lot of work measuring how much resistance trains, how much resistance different trains had. And they also had a locomotive testing laboratory, which is still on campus. And I wonder how many people know which building on the engineering campus is the locomotive dynamometer lab. Which one is it?
I don't know what its current name is.
Yeah. How do you know it's that? Just because you know history? Or okay. For a long time, it was known as the Aero Lab, the aerodynamics lab. Not that they were doing aerodynamics work in there either. I don't know. But the way you can tell, it's the one building on the north, on the quad, that's not perpendicular to the streets. It's at an angle. It's just south of Springfield. And it's because they had a spur off of the old Illinois terminal track that came in there. So the building was aligned for the track coming in. Anyway, those guys did a bunch of work measuring train resistance. And then a guy by the name of W.J. Davis, who worked for General Electric at the time, took all of their data and a lot of other data and came up with what is now known as the Davis equation. And basically, we have several different elements to this. We have a constant. We have a constant that's divided by weight, another constant divided by velocity, and a third one that's basically divided by, multiplied by velocity, and then the third one multiplied by the square of velocity. And these correspond to, again, these key items, which are the weight of the vehicle, B, the one that's correlated with velocity as an experimental friction coefficient for flanges, shock, etc. And then the last one is drag coefficient related to the aerodynamics of the vehicle. And this has been modified and made much more sophisticated since the days of the 1920s and 30s when it was directed, developed, but this basic equation continues to be, the basic form of this equation continues to be what's used. So let's look at a little bit more carefully at this. The sources of rail vehicle resistance are, we'll call them A, B, and C, the resistances that vary with axle load. B are the resistances that vary with speed, and then C are the resistances that vary as a square of speed, and again affected by the aerodynamics. So we have this generic form of the equation, R equals AW plus BV plus CV squared. So let's talk about each of these individually because it relates somewhat to what I was saying earlier. The first ones, resistances that vary with weight, are the journal resistance, the friction between the bearings, the rolling friction of the wheel on the rail that I talked about earlier, and then track deformation. If we actually have a stiffer track, actually provides less resistance because you're not rolling uphill all the time. The resistance that vary directly with speed are flange contact. You'll probably remember that railroad wheels have a flange to hold them on the track. And so if that rubs against the side of the rail, that creates friction. And there's also wheel-rail interface friction and oscillation as shown here. And all of these things contribute resistance that appears to be a linear function of speed. And finally, aerodynamics, and this is going to be the principal subject of the talk today. I think, again, we all understand that a box goes through the atmosphere, through a fluid, less efficiently than something that's more aerodynamic. And in particular, overseas, I should say that the people that are developing very high-speed trains, you know, the Japanese are running trains at 200 miles an hour, as are the French, and or faster, in fact. They've done a lot of work to really, really fine-tune the aerodynamics of just about every element of the vehicle. Now, in this country, when we talk about freight, of course, we're not talking about moving anything anywhere near those kinds of speeds. But even in the realm of 40, 50, 60 miles an hour, aerodynamic effects become very important. And that's, again, part of what we're going to be talking about. Now, when we take all of these terms from our train resistance model, as we call it, we have our A term, that's that bearing resistance, that's a constant function of weight. We have our rolling resistance, which is a linear function of speed, and then C, the Oh, wait a minute. Well, all right. And then we have our air resistance term. And what I want you to notice here is the difference between this graph, which is an intermodal train. And by the way, an intermodal train is one where it's intermodal. We have truck trailers that go on the highway or on rail cars. And so this is an intermodal train right here. We have some flat cars with trailers on them, and there's various forms of that I'll be talking about, versus a conventional freight train. And the scales here are the same. So here's our conventional, in this case, it's a train of hopper cars full of coal compared to that intermodal train. And look at this huge difference, mostly in the aerodynamics. And that's because of two things. One is these gaps. These create turbulence, which cause lots of drag and lots of resistance. And also in the case of trailers, this gap underneath the trailer creates additional sources of turbulence and resistance. So these are the challenges that we're confronted with. All right, so here's a pretty picture, but it's an aerodynamic nightmare, and it's worse if what we call slots are empty. And this is what the railroads call each spot where you can put a trailer or a container. Those are called slots. And so this is a major aerodynamic and energy consumption challenge to the industry today. And the reason it is because intermodal freight is the largest source of revenue to the railroad industry right now, and it's by far the fastest growing. And we, as people who are interested in energy efficiency and sustainability, should be cheering them on, because they're getting those trucks off the highway onto rail cars, moving them with less energy, less production of emissions and noxious pollutants. But it's creating the greatest energy efficiency and environmental challenge for railroad operation that they have, because the only way they can compete with the trucks is to run these trains really fast, 70 miles an hour. Well, that's exactly when these poor aerodynamics really kick in. So the continued growth of this business indicates the need to improve energy efficiency of this type of freight in particular. Sure. Mm-hmm. These are really good questions. I'm going to talk about double stack. When you talk about the ones that are on their own frame, that's something called road railer. Well, no. Oh, well, I say you're saying this. I mean trailers on flat cars, right?
Yeah,
here.
Right.
Yeah, that's right. There's two. Well, there's really three kinds of intermodal traffic these days. There's trailers on flat cars, there's containers on flat cars, which, among other things, are transported double stack, as you're describing. But there's a third kind, which that's what I thought you were referring to, because we live in one of the unusual places in the United States where you can see it on a daily basis. You go down to Tolono, I guess that way maybe, and Norfolk Southern runs what they call a road railer, and that's a unique beast where they swap out, they don't swap them out anymore. They put the trailers directly on a railroad bogie, a truck, and run it right on the rails. And that eliminates this flat car and all that dead weight. Also, they're extremely tightly packed, and so those things are super energy efficient. But there's a whole set of infrastructure required to put them on and off the track, and so there's only limited quarters where they've succeeded economically. There's a lot of people who would like to see them happen more often, but the other side of that is, because they have to run in trains, they're heavier than a standard trailer, so you pay a penalty when you're on the pavement. It's more energy costly in terms of energy efficiency to move them on the pavement, but less costly when they're on the rail. So you can imagine there's a sort of an optimality problem of figuring out when you would use them versus some of these others. But to your point about double stack, I'll be talking about that. Okay, so here's a picture of an intermodal train, and you notice these gaps here. Now, some of them are much larger than others, and so the large ones are the ones that we're concerned with, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. It turns out that both the gap length and the position in train are the two most important factors in affecting intermodal train dynamics. There's a third one, the yaw angle of the wind direction, but since we consider that to be canceled out on average over an entire route, and there's really not much we can do about it anyway, we didn't spend much time studying that. So our focus is on these first two items. Now in particular, of course, we have, again, the train moving through this fluid we call the atmosphere. And first of all, again, it has to push through that. And then there's turbulence created as it passes through it. And the larger these gaps, the more turbulence is created. And I should say also that that turbulence is more significant in the front of the train than the rear of the train as a result of research that the association, we learned that from research that the Association of American Railroads did a couple decades ago, actually. And BNSF has actually been updating that recently. Now, why is the BNSF interested in this problem? Well, because one of their absolute bread and butter routes, sources of income, is this route from the twin ports of Long Beach, Los Angeles to Chicago, what they call the Transcon. This is a intermodal superhighway. I mean, they are running multiple dozens of trains on this line every single day. And, you know, if you drive up Route 47 and what's the name of the town, Libby? Was it? Where do we cross the? What's that?
Dwight.
No, not Dwight. What's that?
Gibson City?
No. Anyway, I'm forgetting right now. But if you just go north on 47, you get to a place where you cross the intermodal double track main line of the BNSF, and they are running these trees. You can stand there, and you'll see a train every 20 or 30 minutes all day long and all night long. And if you think about it, every one of those is holding hundreds of trailers. Those would all be traveling on the highway. So it's obviously a good thing that they're on the railroads. But this energy efficiency question I'm talking about is costing the BNSF a lot of money in terms of fuel consumption. Now, the railroads figured this out a long time ago. And as I referred to earlier, slots, they have put incentives in for the people who work at the terminals to encourage them to make sure they fill up all the slots so that you don't have empty slots creating those gaps that I talked about. And that's a good thing. There's no question that what they call maximizing slot utilization improves energy efficiency because it eliminates these empty slots and the consequent large gaps. But it doesn't account for the different size of the space compared to the load. And so we have two examples here. And it's maybe a little bit hard to see, but we have what we would call a 53-foot well car here, double-stacked, as was referred to earlier. And here we have 53-foot containers in there versus 40-foot containers. And I should say containers come in several different sizes, but those are two of the most common sizes. Well, there's a much bigger gap when you put a 40-foot load in a 53-foot slot than if you put a 53-foot load in a 53-foot slot. And so what we need to really be considering is not only slot utilization, but slot efficiency. So, in other words, we want the right car for the right loads. So, again, we refer back to our general train resistance equation. And remembering the bearing and rolling resistance are primarily affected by weight, the aerodynamic coefficient is determined according to the loading pattern. And so what we did was we used something called the AAR's train energy model to calculate how much energy was required to move this train. And in the examples I'm going to show you in the next couple minutes, we used three locomotives and 20 five-unit intermodal cars. So this is a typical five-unit intermodal car. So each of these would hold a total of 100 slots, so to speak. No. Yeah, right. Now, here's some of the work that was done to find out what mattered in terms of this gap length. And so we're measuring gap length here in feet, and the aerodynamic coefficient in pounds per mile per hour per mile per hour is shown here. And what you see is you reach about 12-foot gap length, and it basically asymptotes. At that point, it's the equivalent of having a hole, just a complete gap in your train. So the key is to move, if you have opportunity to move it into this range down here to lower the gap length. So again, what we refer to as equipment matching, matches the intermodal loads with rail cars to minimize gaps and maximize efficiency. And the capacity of well and spine cars, these are two types of flat cars that handle these intermodal loads, is usually constrained by the length of the loads. And so if we put a 40-foot load into a 40-foot well car, we have a much smaller gap between this one and the next one than if we were to put it into a 48-foot well car. And We can do a similar example with our 48-foot trailer. If we put it into a 48-foot slot versus a 53-foot slot, we're again going to get a smaller gap and therefore better aerodynamics. And if we look at what this means in terms of the aerodynamic coefficient, we can calculate it here. So we have our 40-foot loads, and I should say the 40-foot load, intermodal load, is the standard international container. Those ships that are bringing all the computers and TV sets from the Pacific Rim countries are putting that stuff into 40-foot international containers, as they call them, and all that stuff gets shipped to Chicago and put into a tractor-trailer truck and brought down here to be put in Walmart. So if we put those 40-foot international containers into a 40-foot well car, we have this lower aerodynamic coefficient compared to if we put it into a 48-foot or a 53-foot. And this is what it means in terms of train resistance as a function of speed, because, again, none of these things matter if you're not going very fast, but they mean matter a lot if you're going up in the 50, 60-mile-an-hour range. And so what we have, again, are our 40-foot well, our 48-foot well, and our 53-foot well, and you can see higher train resistance as a result of higher speeds and also poor aerodynamics. But the other thing I should say is the 53-foot well is also a heavier car, and so you're paying an extra penalty in terms of bearing resistance as well. So if we what we did then was we took this train energy model, we took a typical section of the BNSF's main line through Illinois and Iowa, and actually used the actual parameters for that portion of the railroad and put them into this train energy model and calculated what the fuel consumption would be over this 103-mile route, again, with these appropriate these different loading patterns. And what you can see is differences in fuel consumption if we of 13 gallons and then 40 gallons, just as a result of how we've loaded this train. And I think I'll just get all these open. As may already be starting to be evident to you, these effects vary depending upon what kind of equipment we're talking about. So double stacks have a different coefficient than trailers on flat cars, and in fact, actually, there's not too much difference between the 40-foot well and the 48-foot well when you look at the whole different speed range over this route, or over these different speed ranges. So it's only about a 3% difference there. But for the trailers on flat car example, we actually had a 27% difference, corresponding to about 1 gallon per mile per train. And when you start running your trains 2,000 miles from Long Beach to Chicago, we're talking 2,000 gallons of fuel difference every single train that runs that route. So, so here we're comparing double stack containers in well cars versus trailers on spine cars. And if we have 90% slot utilization and we just improve our slot utilization to 100%, we get about a 23% increase in efficiency, but only a rather modest improvement beyond that if we go up to equipment matching. That's for the double stack containers on well cars. But by contrast, we don't get much benefit from additional slot utilization for trailers on spine cars, but we get this 36% benefit if we do, again, proper equipment matching. So this is what we call slot efficiency. It's kind of the step beyond slot utilization. So if we use slot efficiency to monitor the loading efficiency of trains, we can do this by comparing the loads. Each load obviously has its own parameters in terms of length and that sort of thing. And then the rail car fleet also has a whole set of parameters. And all of this is recorded in a database that the Association of American Railroads maintains for the railroad industry called UMLR. And the point is that we have within our means the capability of processing the information about a load's characteristics with the characteristics of a rail car so that we can properly load them to gain more efficient loading patterns and improve the aerodynamics. Now, I should say that's not a freebie. Because there's a reason why there are 53-foot, there's a reason why from an operational standpoint you might prefer 53-foot cars, And that is, you can put anything in them. You can put a 53-foot load in them. You can put a 48-foot load in them. You can put a 40-foot load in them. Whereas if you have a 40-foot car, you can only put 40-foot loads in it. So there's a certain sector within the railroad industry's operational practices groups that say, you know, just give me a car, I can put anything in. I don't want to have to worry about matching things up. But the tide is turning on that, because not only is the energy efficiency better if you match your loads properly, but there's also better capacity. And one of the things the railroads were experiencing until the last year and a half with the economic recession was tremendous constraints in terms of capacity. There was so much traffic they couldn't handle it. And the difference in the length of those 53-foot cars compared to the 40-foot cars meant that they were using up more of their siding space. Now, this may not sound like a big deal, but it was actually making enough of a difference in terms of their ability to move goods over their railroads that they, that this combined with the energy efficiency work that we had done has led to a move to do exactly what we're talking about here, which is to more effectively match loads with rail cars. Now, the next step beyond everything I've just described here is to develop an algorithm to optimize this. Because what really happens in an intermodal loading facility is you have all these loads coming in, and then you have trains of flat cars coming in and out, and you need to very quickly get them loaded and back out going in the other direction. And so the question is, how do you take whatever pool of loads you have available and load them efficiently into the particular train that you have? And so this was one of the key elements of my graduate student Yung Cheng Lai's PhD dissertation, was to develop an optimization model that he called the Aerodynamic Loading Assignment Model, or ALAM. And this model basically takes in all of this information and for any given train spits out an optimal loading configuration. And this is not necessarily much additional burden at all for the terminal operators, because they're making decisions about where to put the loads anyway. And this is just giving them a more efficient means of making those decisions based on aerodynamics. So here's some of the model that he developed, and we don't have to go through all the math, but the point is that there's a whole set of parameters that went into this, and what the key objective function here was what we called Z. It's the adjusted gap length, and that's taking into account not only the gaps in your train, depending on how you load it, but also the factor that I mentioned earlier, that the front of the train experiences more turbulence than the rear of the train, and so you want to weight, so to speak, the gaps in the front of the train more strongly than you would weight the ones in the rear of the train. And this is this aerodynamic loading assignment model. We want to minimize total adjusted gap length. We have loading capacities. These are all constraints, loading capabilities of the cars. We have rules. There's rules to properly operate double stack equipment that we have to abide by. And then there's a weight constant and a length, or I should say weight and length constraints. So again, as I mentioned, the front of the train has more aerodynamic resistance for any given gap than the rear of the train. And so again, that had to be factored into this model. And so we have our drag area. Here's our unit length from the beginning to the rear of the train, the drag area, and then the adjusted factor accounting for this. So the point is that placing loads with shorter gaps in the frontal position generates less aerodynamic resistance. So again, our objective was to minimize this total adjusted gap length within the train. So what we then did was we applied ALAM to an example train based on data that we'd actually received from the BNSF Railway. They gave us a whole bunch of data on trains running back and forth between Los Angeles and Chicago. And then we also had data on all the cars and the train makeup, and so the question was, all right, how do we mix and match and shuffle these loads onto this train to get the greatest efficiency? And so what we found was that if we used ALAM, we could have a total adjusted gap length of 514 feet, whereas the worst possible case, if you loaded it just the worst way you could, which is perfectly plausible for an operator to do that. There was no reason for him not to do it because he's still having 100% slot utilization here. Then he had 1,170 feet of adjusted gap length. So you can see there's quite a bit of difference between the worst case and the best case. So in this case, the fuel savings would be just about, again, a gallon per mile per train. So then what we did was we took, again, this data from these trains that were operating between Chicago and L.A., And there's really four kinds of intermodal trains. There's international stack trains, there's domestic stack trains, TOFSI-COFSI, that means trailer on flat car or container on flat car, and then there's mixed trains, which are mixtures of the above. And what you see is that there's a different potential benefits from using ALAM, because what we have here is the average and then the worst and the best. This is the range of possibilities for total adjusted gap length. So you see actually the international stack train, there's not much potential variability. And so applying ALAM there isn't going to really give you that much benefit. But by contrast, our domestic stack train or our TOFSI-COFSI train or our mixed train all have a much wider range of possibilities. And so the width of that bar is essentially telling you how much potential there is to improve energy efficiency of these trains. Now, what we would expect, I don't want you to think that you're going to go from there to there. You're not, because what we would expect is that operators, on average, are loading sort of somewhere in the middle. You know, sometimes they're out here, sometimes they're out here. But if they used ALAM, then they could always be down at the left hand of these bars. So we can then calculate what these mean in terms of fuel savings per mile. So we kind of readjust our sort of flow chart of what we want to do to use the adjusted slot efficiency to monitor the loading efficiency of trains and develop this strive actually for 100% in terms of the length of the actual load versus the length of the ideal load. All right. So some of the conclusions and recommendations we made to the railroads on this were that obviously you want to try to load your trains using this adjusted slot efficiency. We also did some other work that I didn't talk about here on filling empty slots with empty containers. It turns out that if you have empty containers around under certain conditions, it actually makes more sense to put an empty container in an empty slot and run it than to let that slot be empty. And also uncoupling empty rail cars from the end of the loaded trains when practical to reduce weight and fuel consumption. That's kind of common sense. And again, as we say, our maximum fuel efficiency possible is about a gallon per mile per train. Now, this concludes this part of the talk, and I have about 10 more slides where I can talk about this machine vision automated monitoring system that we've developed as part of this work as well. So I'm going to sort of turn to Nancy and ask if you want me to continue for 10 more slides, or should I? Okay, I think this is pretty quick, I think. I think hopefully I've made the case for why the BNSF would be interested in this problem of loading their trains more efficiently. And so in addition to sponsoring the sort of analytical work I've just told you about, they also wanted to understand, well, how can we monitor the performance of our own terminal manager who are loading these trains? And so what we decided was that we could use something called machine vision or computer vision to scan trains as they go by and automatically record these gaps and how well they did. And so we teamed up with the computer vision and robotics lab in Beckman and developed a machine vision system to do exactly this. And this is a picture of one of our test installations up outside of Chicago. This is the camera, this is the train entering, and it's going to record what it sees. And what you just saw was basically the image acquisition system. The other key piece of this are what we call machine vision algorithms. That's obviously the computer codes to take all of these huge volume of digital images and actually extract useful information from them. And then a data analysis system to take that data that these things create and then provide useful information for the railroads. So we first did field tests where we just went out with permission from BNSF and recorded trains going by, again, outside of Chicago. That gave us enough information to develop a prototype system, which we installed at a place called Logistics Park, which is a big freight and as the name implies, it's a big logistics facility that BNSF has built south of Joliet, Illinois. And our site was, I should say, their main line is right over here. I think you can see it right there. And then this is the connection to their line, and then this is gigantic. It's the old Joliet Arsenal. Some of you probably have been there. And our site was right over here by the entrance where the trains came in. So it's not very, very much to see here. You have a camera, a little box with the electronics hardware in it, and a communications antenna there. And basically, this is just a plan view of what you're seeing. We have loop detectors to detect the presence of a train, our camera tower, our antenna tower, and our equipment enclosure. And here we have it in a profile view. You can see what the camera is seeing. In this case, we've depicted a double stack train. And let me tell you how, just some of the simple basics of how these algorithms work. It's kind of one of the things that it's good about being a researcher at a university is you get to dabble in new things all the time. And I had no idea about machine vision when this all started. And but my colleagues in electrical engineering obviously did. And so the first thing we had to do was take these images and subtract the background so that we understood what we were interested in. In this case, we're interested in the train. So there's algorithms that allow you to do this. It's just this, the difference image between what's the difference between the normal background and this train that's passing through it. And so you can create these images and subtract the background from the foreground. And so now we can see our locomotive as it enters. And then this needs to be continually updated because the background can change. And in fact, the most recent development was that they now have an algorithm that works with a completely dynamic background. And so this is really increasing the flexibility with where we can install one of these things. Then the next step is to take these images and generate what we call a panorama. And so the middle section of each frame contributes to the construction of this panorama. And I think we have a little animation here. So what happens, it just keeps taking slices out, matches up the pixels, and stitches them all together into one big panorama. And that's where that picture I showed you earlier came from. It's literally a picture of an entire train. And I would dare say that nobody's ever done that before, taken one single picture of an entire train, at least not from so close. So here's our panorama. And this is actually, of course, not the whole train, but a significant fraction of it. And so we've been generating these for all these trains going by and developing algorithms that can actually measure these different gaps. Well, but it's not as simple as measuring gaps because you have to know what you're looking at. Because remember what I said, trailers have different gaps and matching with rail cars than containers, and even different rail cars vary as well. And so there has to be some more intelligence in these algorithms. So in this case, it's recognizing that these are containers and that this is a double stack container and this is a single stack container, and it's finding the edges and measuring the gap. Here it's correctly detected a single stack container, and again, correctly located the top as well as the end. Then it's correctly detecting double stacks and correctly detecting trailers. So the idea is that we take all this information. We have our train monitoring module. It generates a gap document and report, and it also generates this panorama and does all the calculations that I've been talking about to provide this information to the people who are loading the trains. And so the idea is that once we have this, we can communicate this information to the people who actually work in these yards and decide which loads are going to go in which cars and create a computer sort of a list, if you will, that says put this load here, which they have, by the way. I mean, this is an actual picture of what they're using right now, but it's based simply on maximizing slot utilization. And so all we feel we need to do is have them add these extra parameters and algorithms to the optimization process I described earlier and optimize the loading. And then that combined with the machine vision system can help them keep track of how well they're doing and allow them to make sure that their terminal operators and managers are in fact doing what they're supposed to be doing. And so with that, I'm going to conclude and ask if there are any questions at this point. Yes.
Uh-huh. And look at the train modeling that they have up in Chicago showing the movement of the train. how much delay is necessary in relationship to moving the freight through Chicago because of the passenger train. So the bottom line question to me is, for all this work on optimizing all this loading in relationship to the loss that these freight companies have because of the huge delays in 5, 6, 7 hours,
how do they work? Well, I'm going to give you the easy answer and say both. what you're talking about is known as CREATE. I forget exactly what that's in Chicago, regional, environmental, something. But basically, Chicago has been known as what we call the Gordian knot of the North American rail network for about 100 years. And for the last decade, the railroads, the city of Chicago, the state of Illinois have been trying to sort of garner the support to do all this massive infrastructure work to fix all of these congestion problems. And that's slowly coming together. It's not coming together as rapidly as I think everybody hoped. Ironically, one of the things that's holding it up is all the environmental impact statements you have to do and the permits you have to get permission to do this work, even though it's clearly going to be good for the environment to do it. But that doesn't take away at all from the fact. I know you're not suggesting that. The point is that, you know, when we run a train 2,000 miles to Chicago, we want to have it to be as fuel efficient as possible, and then when we get to Chicago, we want to get across town as quickly as possible as well. So, I think that's the answer to the question. Yes.
Fuel efficiency in terms of gallons per ton per mile, et cetera. Do you have a way of taking into account how efficient the rail movement is against, say, trucks over the mountain ranges, say, from New York to Seattle, versus the run you showed, which I think is a fairly smooth run compared to the mountain
range? Yeah, I've thought about that a little bit. And, of course, the BNSF's got across. They've got to cross the Rocky Mountains just like any tractor trailer does, too, when they get down to the southwest. And there's, I think their maximum elevation above sea level is somewhere in the 4,000 to 5,000 feet above sea level range. So they're lifting that freight from whatever it is at Chicago. What are we, about 80 feet above sea level? No, it's more than 80. It's a few hundred. Yeah, right. I'm sorry, I was off by a decimal order of magnitude. Yeah, so 600 feet to 4,000 feet, and then back down again. They're doing that both ways. The truckers are doing the same thing. I don't know that there's a difference in the energy efficiency of lifting weight between truck and. I think the physics, the basic physics, would be that that's not going to be different. It's these other forms of resistance. But I'm. That's true. So if your load to tear ratio, is higher for trucks, which I wouldn't jump to the conclusion that that is either. That's one of the facts of railroads. There's a whole bunch of constraints. If you're going to run trains that are a mile and a half long, you have to have very robust vehicles. Every single vehicle has got to be able to pull a mile and a half of freight behind it, whereas the trucks only have to be strong enough to support their own weight. That's why those so-called road railer trailers are more robust and more heavier. Is because they do have to suffer those in-train forces. So I've never actually asked that question. It's an interesting question, but I wouldn't be surprised if trucks are comparable, if not even better, than rail in terms of load to tear. So that notwithstanding, railroads are still making up for that in terms of their energy efficiency because of these other parameters. Yeah, I think what you're referring to is, in fact, I was realizing just as I was finishing preparing this presentation, I think I had the term AEI in there, which I realize nobody in this audience was probably going to know. But AEI is automatic equipment identification, and it's the analog to a barcode system, but it's actually a what do they call it? They scan it with a a microwave and it echoes back digitized information. So yes, they have. Well, that problem's not as bad as it used to be because what I remember when I was sort of first learning about the railroad industry was that they did have a barcode system, an optical system, just like in the supermarkets, basically. And you can still occasionally see them on the rail cars. And it basically didn't work. I mean, it worked when everything worked right, but I think dirty rail cars and things like that caused it to not work very well. So they kind of went back to the drawing board and said, all right, we need something that's filth-proof, basically. And they came up with this, I can't remember the right name for these kinds of electronic tags, but it's probably the same idea as what you have in your toll things. Yeah, it's that kind of technology. And so every single rail car and every locomotive in North America has this unique AEI tag and identification, and they have these readers. There's thousands of readers out on the network now. And so I think that their data systems are much better than they were, say, 20, 25 years ago in terms of keeping track of where equipment is. It's not to say that they never lose things, but they definitely are better than they used to be. I know that. Yes, sir?
You start off with saying it's 457 is a magic number.
I'm sorry?
457? What does that really refer to? Does it have any meaning given all this complexity for which you are measuring?
Well, 457 is the average. It's the average for the U.S. Class One railroads, the big railroads in North America. It's the average of. They move. It's really simple to calculate. You just take, we moved this many tons, this many miles, and we consumed this much fuel. That's about as it's as simple as that. Except, that's the average. Now there's a big range, of course, and in fact. The kinds of vehicles I've been talking about aren't as efficient. I mean, as we've just been discussing, they're in fact the least efficient. So the one thing I'll say with some confidence is that we're not moving intermodal trailers 457 miles per ton of fuel. Some number less than that. It's still better than on the highway, but not as much better. And I should say that there were some vehicles were moving better than 457 because. Again, that's an average. So that's somewhere in the middle in terms of the extremes of the efficiency of the overall rail freight transportation system. But I don't know the specific number for.
What's the difference between, say, moving a ton of freight by train versus moving it versus truck? Is it a really large difference or a very small difference?
It's very much related to distance. What railroads talk about is sort of the threshold, the distance threshold where moving things via intermodal becomes more economical. And the number that's been around for a long time is in the 600, 700, 800 miles range. If you're moving something less than that and it's truck competitive, now some things aren't truck competitive, but anything that could go by truck, you're probably not going to move it intermodally if it's less than about 600 miles. But if it's 1,000 or 2,000 miles, it's probably more economical to move it by truck. And there are ways that you can do shorter distance. Oh, we're going to get the slideshow here, sorry. there are ways that you can develop essentially an operational model where even much shorter distances can be economical by rail. There's a lot of factors that it's not just economics. It has to do with service quality and everything else and what the customer's expectations are and reliability. Railroads are very efficient, but they struggle a lot with reliability for a set of reasons that are intrinsic to their efficiency. That's the cruel irony. Yes, sir.
So I really like your computer vision model that you're showing, but it seems a bit overkill, doesn't it? I mean, I'm wondering why don't you use just like a simple garage door sensor, like a stack of those to measure the camera.
We thought about that, and it turns out to be not as simple as you might think. There were a bunch of reasons why. One thing was the railroad wanted to be in a position of going back and actually looking at the real trains and seeing, what train was not loaded correctly. But was also a stepping stone to a more sophisticated comprehensive set of things that, which we're just going to start. We're starting to just dip our toes into now as we get our field site out. I don't know if I mentioned that, but we're now building our first site out on the main line at a place called Sibley, Missouri, which is about 50 miles east of Kansas City. And they want to look at all their trains, not just the intermodal trains. And there's a whole host of energy efficiency and aerodynamic questions they want to ask using this system. So I think this was kind of a way to open the door, so to speak. Yes?
The waterway industry is talking a lot about moving containers by barge from the Gulf Coast and other places, particularly where the Panama Canal is widened. Mm-hmm. That's going to bring up the old 70s battle over what's the energy efficiency of barges versus trains. What's the current feeling on that?
Well, I've certainly heard the railroads talking about how the Panamax Canal, the Panama Canal widening is going to change their traffic patterns. They're already planning for it. They're expecting more freight to come into some of the East Coast ports like Norfolk and Savannah, and it's not going to be traveling, as much of it's not going to be traveling across the country, at least percentage-wise. Now, of course, if you consider the traffic tends to grow anyway. But to your point specifically, if we go back to, I think, one of my early slides where I showed water transport versus rail, they're definitely more energy efficient, but they're also slower. So the freight that tends to be in containers tends to be high-value merchandise where the shipper doesn't want it tied up in inventory, essentially, in transit. And so, again, it's gonna, the marketplace is going to sort that out, I'm sure. That where the customer is satisfied to have a slower delivery but lower cost, then that's what they'll probably do. And
is there any work on changing the design of the rail cars themselves to be more aerodynamic?
That's a really good question, and that really has come, it really comes out in all of this. Is there a way to make these things? And there's ways you can do it, but they. Nobody's come up with it that I'm aware of a way to do it that sort of doesn't substantially impact the practicality of the operation. For instance, you can imagine putting some airfoils in or something like that, but then it's going to get in the way when you start trying to load and unload containers, and inevitably they're going to get damaged because somebody will swing a container into it and smash the airfoil, and so. But I will say this, if anybody's got an idea that's practical, go patent it because you'll be a millionaire. Yes?
What about any research on the rail? I know there was a big trend toward tearing up a lot of rails. The other one is that a lot of them need a lot of work. So is that sort of figured in before they have the
application? Yeah, actually, I'm going to respectfully disagree with a couple of the points. They removed a lot of trackage was removed in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and even a little bit still being removed. That was we overbuilt our railroad infrastructure in this country. It was rational. It may have been rational to build what we built before we had a well-developed highway transportation system, but there was a lot of rail lines that were built to move traffic that now makes more sense to move by highway. And so once you have highways, and I also don't want to take away from the trucking industry. The trucking industry is doing a huge amount to make its own transportation more efficient. And so there are, every mode has its place. And so what happened was that we removed a lot of trackage that was no longer necessary. And that was also essential from an economic standpoint because maintaining all of that track was killing the railroads. That was why they were in one of the reasons they were in economic distress in the 60s and 70s was that their infrastructure was enormously overbuilt and they were maintaining it all and the traffic wouldn't support it. They're now moving more traffic than they ever have in their history, well, not this year, but last year, or the year before. 2007 was the last, it went down and now it'll go up again, is going up again. But in 2007, they moved more freight than they ever have in the history of railroads in this country with considerably less infrastructure than they once had. And the infrastructure now is, in general, in extremely good condition. because what happened in 1980 was they were deregulated. They were no longer being told by the government what they could charge. They were free to function in a marketplace. It made it an attractive investment. It made them able to price their business so that it was matched what the customer needed. That then drew back investors who then invested in the infrastructure. And so now the railroads are profitable. And, you know, Warren Buffett just bought the BNSF railway, if that's not a statement about, some kind of statement about the value of the industry as it is right now. I'm sorry, what? Well, the CN, you mean, in town here? The CN has been expanding for a number of years. They bought the Illinois Central, the railroad through town here. They bought the Wisconsin Central. They bought some smaller railroads. And then the most recent acquisition was their acquisition of the Elgin, Joliet, and Eastern. And that's actually related to the question that was asked before about traffic through Chicago, because the EJ&E, as it's called, or the J, is essentially a beltway around Chicago that was completely underused. They're running maybe 5 trains a day on that. And instead of all this, and the CN, they have 5 lines that come into Chicago. No other railroad has railroads coming in. You know, the BNSF goes to the west, and the UP goes to the west, and CSX and Norfolk Southern go to the east. But CN comes in from the north, the east, the south, and 2 ways to the west, I think. And so every single piece of traffic that they had to wander through downtown Chicago, as was being referred to earlier. And so they said, why don't we buy this belt line, and instead of running 5 trains a day on it, let's run 20 trains a day on it. And that's exactly what they did, despite some opposition from some of the communities. But that was, I mean, from a transportation efficiency standpoint, that was an extremely good thing to do, because it took this underutilized asset that was and allowed CN to pull almost all of its traffic out of Chicago. And therefore, not only they get better service, but they stop interfering with all the other roads that still have to go through Chicago.